Hello everyone, I hope all of you would be fine. I welcome you all in a new session of F4 Business Law on behalf of Smart Study. So I'm Yusuf and we are going to take an introduction class of Business and Corporate Law F4. So let's start with my introduction. I'm an ACCA member. I have done MS Finance and MCOM, and I have also attended BSc Applied Accounting. I have 9 years teaching experience in different reputable ACCA institutes. I also have 6 years industry and firm experience in relevant audit and investment functions and in different banking sections. I have been an expert tutor for F4, F1, F8, SPL and PSAM. So I also have been part of different ACCA programs like practice to pass session, read the mind of marker and coffee with the tutor. And I have some nationwide distinctions in F4, SPL, P3 and P7 as well. So this is a brief introduction of mine. So let's start with the main question and with the introduction of the course of F4. So the basic point is why F4 is the part of ACCA. So this is a core question. You know, F4 is business law, corporate law, and you are meant to become a certified chartered accountant. So as a certified chartered accountant, why you need to have a good understanding of the law? Whereas you are not going to become a lawyer, you want to become the accountant, you want to become a certified chartered accountant. So why at this level of ACCA, this paper is introduced? What is the reason? What is the rationale behind it? So the question is, as an accountant, you guys must be familiar with debit, credit and financial statements. This is your core activity. This should be your core knowledge. So you should have a good understanding of the investments, the financial decisions. You should be familiar with the financial statements, accounting standards, ISAs. So this is your future. But at this level, you are going to study the law. So what is the reason to study the law at this level? So the answer to that question is very important. And you need to know why we are going to study this paper. So let's try to understand this issue with a case study. So this is a case study. You can see ICO fines British Airways £20 million for security breach. So this is an event occurred on October 16. You can see on October 16, 2020, the UK Information Commissioner's Office, ICO, announced fine of £20 million for British Airways. British Airways is a very renowned airline and it travels across the world and it has a very good brand name across the world. So they have been found for £20 million. So what happened basically, an unidentified attacker gained access to BA British Airways IT system and network. And what happened? The attacker was able to redirect customer payment card data from BA website to fraudulent site controlled by the attacker. So an attacker got access to the very secure system of the customer. And what happened as a result of that attack? Customer personal data such as name, address, and the payment card details were harvested, as well as login details of BA employees and administrative accounts. So this is what has happened. So there is basically a law that is data protection law. And according to this law, the employer is responsible for the protection of data. Protection of data. So the British Airways was in breach of this data act. Due to this, the important data of the customer and the data of employees and the administrator data was leaked, and it was used for different fraudulent activities. So it caused damage to the customers, and customers sued British Airline. So what is the role of accountant here? So as an accountant, you are responsible for booking of provision of this case that is filed on British Airways. But what is the relation of studying law in that context? So we can see, as an accountant, our responsibility is to manage company cash flows and increase profit. So this is our ultimate goal as an accountant. We need to reduce the expenses and we need to increase the revenue. Ultimately, it will increase the profits. So the company can achieve its objectives, but how can you fulfill your duty without knowing data protection acts? So this means that this year, company's profit will be reduced by 20 million pounds. So 20 million pound is an expense which company has to bear, and company's profits will reduce. So if the accountant had knowledge of the Data Protection Act, and if he had taken reasonable measures to reduce the impact of that breach, company would have higher profits than this scenario. So this has caused the loss in the profit of the company. So as an accountant, we should be familiar with the relevant laws in which the company is working, and the environment and the industry in which company is prevailing. So it is very important to have a good understanding of laws and regulations. So this is what we are going to study in chapter 2, that is contract law. So that is why it is very important, and it is taught to you guys at this level. So let's take another example, Toyota. So we know that Toyota is also a very big brand name in automobile industry. So many Toyota owners and passengers claim that they have been injured in crashes caused by the Toyota's defective accelerator pedal. So typically these individuals bring a personal injury lawsuit in state court, including defective product liability claim. So what happened here, that company manufactured a product which had a defective accelerator pedal, due to which the customer sustained different injuries. So what happened is injury to customer. When there is a physical injury to customer or physical injury to its property, customer is going to sue the company. So that product was manufactured by the company. So company is responsible for any injury, loss, or damage to the customer due to the product that the company has made. So that is why now our accountant's responsibility is to record all the debits and credits. Okay, that is right. But the accountant should be aware of the relevant laws due to which company's expenses can be increased. So as an accountant, our responsibility is to manage company's cash flows once again and to increase the profits. But how can we increase the profits or can achieve our objectives if an accountant is unaware of the manufacturing defaults, or the production department is not working fairly, correctly, and the product has certain types of defects? So a defective product will cause damage to the reputation of the company, not only to the reputation of the company, but also it will cause to decrease the profits of the company. So yes, this is an ultimate responsibility of the production department, manufacturing department, but the accountant also has a secondary responsibility in it, and this is called the negligence, and we will discuss this negligence event in chapter 3. So this is also a part of our course plan. So there's another example. Nestle paid $2 million to an employee for basically dismissing him on unfair matters. So a former high-ranking food safety executive at Nestle has won an 8-year legal battle against the world's biggest food company after a Swiss appeal court ruled that she had been unlawfully harassed and forced out of her job. So if a company is involved in such type of events and company don't know how to basically dismiss an employee, so what will happen? These types of cases will occur again and again, and we can see company had to pay $2 million to this employee. So this is once again loss to the company's profits. So this is very important for accountant to know that how an employee must be dismissed. If that particular employee would have dismissed according to the laws, company would not have to pay this $2 million amount. So this is very important in context to the accountant to not only record the transaction, but to guide the company on the matter and on the course of action that company is going to pursue in future. So the accountant must be in good knowledge and understanding of the relevant laws and regulations in which the company is working. So the employment laws are the part of chapter 4, and we are going to study these important points in chapter 4. So these were some case studies to help you out that why we are studying F4 corporate and business law at this stage. So I think it would be very much clear to you that why we are going to study this. So the aim of ACCA corporate business law is to develop knowledge and skills in the understanding of the general legal framework. So if you are working in Nigeria, or you are working in USA, or you are working in India, or you are a part of an organization of a global multinational company, so wherever you are working, there will be a general legal framework in that company, and there will be some specific legal areas of the business. So as an accountant, you must have familiarity with those legal frameworks, with the laws, with the rules and the regulations, so that you must make sure that your company is in compliance with these laws and regulations. Otherwise, the dream of increasing the profit will be vanished. So not only the other relevant departments are responsible, but the accountant is also responsible to make sure that all the activities of the companies are done according to the laws and regulations. This is the ultimate or core purpose of this syllabus in your area. This is F4. So if we move further, what are the contents of this syllabus? We can see chapter 1, English legal system. So in English legal system, we are going to study different court types. So chapter 1 is basically an introduction chapter. This is a conceptual chapter. We are going to study different sorts of concepts. What is judicial precedent? What is civil law? What is criminal law? And what is most importantly the court system of the UK? So chapter 1 deals with the English legal system. If a company is involved in a civil dispute with a supplier, so in which court he is going to sue? So the answer of this question will be gathered in chapter 1. So as far as chapter 2 is concerned, contract law. So we know companies are nowadays involved in different types of contractual relationships between the suppliers and the customers. So whenever you purchase a product like Pepsi, you basically enter in a contract with the Pepsi. So you are going to give the money and company is going to provide you the product Pepsi. So there are some rights on you and there are some rights that companies have. So if one of the party is going to breach the obligation or the liability, then the other innocent party is going to sue under the breach of contract law. So this all is covered in contract law. Then there is law of tort, in which we are going to study the negligence. Very important point, negligence. So if an employee is driving a truck of company on a road and by negligence he is caught in an accident, so the employee, on behalf of employer, not only employee is responsible, but employer is also responsible for the act of negligence of the employee. So that is why a company needs to understand what are the areas, what are the processes that are open to the risk of the negligence, and they must mitigate these risks at every level. So we are going to cover another important type of negligence that is called professional negligence. So this is a professional negligence that is related to the accountants and auditors. So this is interesting. How can accountant or auditor be considered as a negligent in his working, yes, accountant may be considered as a negligent one when he has made a financial statement based on certain types of misstatements. So if there would be another accountant, he would not have these sorts of the errors. So this accountant is negligent as he has not accounted for all the transactions according to the accounting standards. And same is the case with the auditor. If auditor says that the financial statements of the Coca-Cola are true and fair, whereas after some time it is seen, it is observed that the financial statements are not true and fair, so auditor will be sued for the case of professional negligence because he was negligent in performing the audit of that company. So these are very important matters that need to be considered here. Employment law is also very important. Accountant must know that who is our employee and who is self-employed, what are the employee laws, what is the notice period, what are the rules related to unfair dismissal and fair dismissal and wrong dismissal and constructive dismissal. So these concepts will be discussed in chapter 4. In chapter 5, we are going to discuss the agency law. Nowadays, company normally hires agents for different purposes. So when an agent involved in a contract, whether agent is responsible for any misstatement or principal is going to be responsible. So the fiduciary duties of agent, the formation of the relationship of the agent, all these important matters will be discussed in chapter 5. Now, these four chapters are the part of business law. And these coming chapters are the corporate law. We know F4 stands for business and corporate law. So the corporate law, in which we are going to study the functions of the corporate, the introduction of the corporation, how a share will be issued, how the company will be working. So first of all, in this chapter, type of business organization, we are going to study how an organization evolves. So we know that company starts with in the form of sole leadership, then it is converted to partnership, and partnership is ultimately converted into company. So company has also two types, private company and public company. So what are these types and how they are transferred, and what are the role of shareholders and partners here? We are going to study all this stuff in chapter 6. In chapter 7, we are going to study an important emphasis on the legal personality of the company. We know company is a legal separate entity. So what is the article of association of company? What are the roles of the shareholders of the company? How company can be made? How can the company registered? So all these important points are covered in chapter 7. And in chapter 8, we have two major portions to be covered. First, capital, and second, financing. So if company needs capital, they can issue shares. So how shares are issued, what are the types of shares, what is the face value of shares, how a share can be issued on premium. So all these important rules according to Companies Act 2006 must be learned here. And as far as financing is concerned, we are going to study long-term debts and debentures. So debenture is a tricky term. Debentures have certain coupon rates. Debentures have certain maturity rates. Debentures need to be registered. So what are the rules and regulations of the debentures? We are going to study this in chapter 8. As far as chapter 9 is concerned, the directors. Directors is also an agent of the company, and he takes the most important decisions of the company. So what are the types of the directors? How a director can be appointed and how a director can be removed? So all these important points will be discussed in chapter number 9. And we will also learn that if a director is involved in a criminal offense, director can be disqualified for more than 10 years. So what are the events? What are the transactions in which the director is going to involve? He is going to disqualify for more than 10 years. So as a director, as a future director of a company, you should be aware of these criminal offenses. Now about corporate administration, we are going to study different important items like what is the role of auditor, what is the role of company secretary, how a notice is served, what are the types of the resolution. So all these important facts will be covered here. And the insolvency means liquidation. So if a company is not working well, company has cash flow problem, so company needs to be liquidated. So what are the types of liquidation? We will study the Liquidation Act 1986, and according to this act, how a company will be liquidated. This is important. And the last chapter, corporate and fraudulent behaviors. It includes all the criminal offenses. We are going to study all the criminal offenses here, the crimes in which auditor or accountant can be involved. So which crimes are there in which auditor or accountant can be involved, like money laundering, like bribery, like fraudulent behavior, like wrongful trading, fraudulent trading. So all these, or we can say stock market abuse. So all these are very important criminal offenses, and there are a lot of heavy penalties involved in it. And if auditor or accountant is unaware of these important offenses, he can fall into any of the trap that is set for him, or he can cause of the criminal offense or the bad reputation for the company as well. So the accountant auditor must be aware of all these important things. So these components of F4 syllabus are very important and very applicable. So as far as the exam format of F4 is concerned, so we can see there are two sections, section A and section B. So section A includes, we can see, section A has objective test questions. And some questions, means 25 questions are of 2 marks and 20 questions are of 1 mark. So objective test questions are normally 1 line or 2 line question, and certain options are provided. This is a computer based paper and it has 70 marks in total. Whereas section B has multi-task questions in which a scenario will be provided and different options will be given. So there are total 5 MTQs having 6 marks. So total they have 30 marks. So out of 100, 30 marks are awarded to section B multi-task questions and 70 marks are awarded to section A objective test questions. So you have 2 hours to finish this paper. So what is our methodology to deal with all these important points? So yes, we will follow Kaplan study text and Kaplan kit. Kaplan is one of the easiest book to study in F4. This is short and normally students like to read this book because they are not normally, they don't have excessive detail. So the important points are written in short and they are enough for students to memorize. So Kaplan book and Kaplan kit is important. We're going to study with that. Don't miss lectures. This is very important point in F4 because this is law. And we as a student are not basically have a good knowledge of law historically. So if you have missed 2 or 3 classes, it is very difficult to understand the topic that we are going to study the next day, because a topic that is going to study today, or we are going to learn a topic today, will have linked with previous classes. So if you have missed previous classes, it will be impossible to understand what we are studying today. So never miss a class. If something happens, you have recorded lectures, access to the recorded lectures, you must go through them before the start of the next class. So note taking is very important activity. You will be provided with the PDF format of the lecture, and this can be useful and helpful for you. But you should also write important things and important examples which we are going to study here and which are verbal in their nature. Listen carefully what we are studying. Two-way communication is very important. If you have any question, you can ask me. You can ask me question in class. You can ask me question through WhatsApp group. You can inquire a question through text box in a Zoom. So there are multiple options you have. So book reading along with the lectures is very important because there is a legal language involved in it, and language is very difficult and very typical. So this typical language needs to understand. So you need to memorize some important core concepts, and for this you need to read the book properly. Highlighting and underlining important areas is very important, and memorizing and revision is very important. So there are some case laws And case laws are the stories of the application of law. So if you are not aware of the case laws, you will not be able to attempt MTQs. MTQs in section B of 30 marks, we have studied that. So you need to memorize these case laws. The story and the facts and the judgment made by the court are important, and student must have memorized them. So unless you have memorized these important case laws, it is very difficult to pass the exam. So you must memorize and you must take on the home assignments that are given to you after the end of each class. So we will, how we are going to plan our study and how we are going to do that. Time is very important. You know, this is a CBE paper and you can attempt the paper whenever you want. So this is very important that you limit your plan according to the time. And we are going to split the time of session, 1 hour of study. And if there is any discussion, whenever the class will be start, we are going to first of all discuss the important key points of the previous lecture. And the timetable, you must plan yourself, you must make a study plan, you must see other commitments that you have, and you must give 1 hour daily minimum to revise all the important points. So if you are studying more than one paper, yes, you need to basically adopt a more rigorous type of approach to study both subjects. You must give proper time to both subjects. This is very important. So this is how we are going to study. So I'm very hopeful that this session would be very helpful for you guys, and for the next coming classes you will work very hard, and we will devise a plan and we will make law very easy so that you can concentrate and you can pass this paper easily. So for today, that's it for the today. So dear students, I hope to see you soon in the next classes. Take care and goodbye.